Welcome to the Future Sickos podcast with your hosts, Brennan Detzler and Derek Lee.
What is up? Welcome back to the Future Sickos podcast, the first episode of the 2022-2023 season. And we're extremely excited to kick it off with none other than the King of Captains. Brady, you're looking a little bigger already since the last offseason. I don't know if it's just the sleeveless shirt showing off the shoulders or what it is, but how are you doing, Brady? And how excited are you to be back?
Yeah, no, I'm fired up. It was, I've been here for a week now and been able to do a lot of things with the guys, and you just feel the excitement and everybody's ready to go.
Unreal. And so some of those guys, it sounds like you had a big football weekend, or did you get in on any of the fantasy football action? Was Josh Allen the first overall pick for you, or how did it go down?
Yeah, it was a good week. I wouldn't say it was a blowout type fantasy football weekend for myself, but you know, good steady weekend. I got the job done. But yeah, it's always fun to be, you know, Sundays on the couch watching football. Got the red zone going for, you know, TV here, so watching all the nonstop action from every game. So forgot how much fun watching football was. So it's definitely nice to kind of get that back going, and I'm right in time for the season. So it was definitely a lot of fun.
Yeah, no, it's always a great way to spend the Sunday on the couch and not feel too guilty about it. But speaking of being a spectator of sports, I guess, if that's how we're going to start it off, I think you won the hearts over of another fan base this summer. As much as the Sens have always obviously adored their captain since you rolled in here, you were also kind of became, I want to say, maybe even the official mascot of the Calgary Flames over the summer when you're in the Saddle Dome, getting the people fired up. Can you kind of talk about just what it was like to experience that as a fan, and how great it was to kind of like be in that moment and be able to support Matthew like that?
Yeah, no, that was probably like, you know, that last point you just made, just, it was all about supporting Matthew and being there for him. And no, I kept saying to him, if it ever became a distraction, I'll you know, cut the shenanigans out, because like, I love it. I think it's great. So that was the only thing that really mattered to me, but it was pretty cool. Just the atmosphere, you know, the playoff atmosphere and just how much the city was buzzing. I think that provided me with, you know, more motivation throughout the summer and coming here and want to experience that for myself, and being able to walk out in the CTC and having that place, you know, packed for and buzzing for meaningful games and just to kind of play off that atmosphere would be pretty amazing. It definitely gave me, you know, more motivation coming into this year.
And I'm wondering too, you know, how it felt, you know, while we're on the topic of Matthew, he had some big changes this summer. So how does that feel now that you have him playing in Florida in your division? Does that change those matchups, those Kachuk matchups?
Absolutely. You know, you can almost get away with it playing, you know, twice a year to make it more of like a, you know, fun catching up thing. But now being in the same division, those games matter. And those are crucial points, and every game's a crucial point. But yeah, I mean, we were talking that, you know, it's definitely, we're super excited. And then as it kind of sunk in, we realized that we could be knocking one of each other out of the playoffs down the road. So that was something that turned from a lot of laughs into more of a serious conversation where, you know, probably our parents aren't going to be happy if we end up matching up down the road, but at least one of us is going to move on. But those are what you kind of want, is playing those meaningful games, especially against him. It's going to be, you know, pretty cool experience for everyone, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I was going to say too, like, you know, how's your mom going to feel if you guys meet in the playoffs? What's that going to look like?
I feel bad because I don't know how she's going to take it. I think her stress will be through the roof. So, you know, be happy that, of course, somebody's going to move on, but we'll be very sad for the other that doesn't.
Fair enough.
Is it bittersweet kind of knowing that, like, you'll get to see him probably about eight times through the year, but when you do get to see him, you're going to be going to battle against him?
Yeah, no, it's definitely going to be, I think we both do a good job that, know, away from the rink, it's, you know, of course, they're just the normal guys and just, you know, hang out when we have the chance, especially against each other. But we're both under the mindset that, you know, these games matter, and these games are huge divisional games that, you know, both of our respective teams, you know, must win to keep improving. So, yeah, we're just going to have to keep dialing in there. And yeah, I mean, it's going to be fun. It's going to be fun for everybody around us to be a part of some pretty important games. And it's just, it is going to be different because, you know, playing Calgary, it's, you know, it's out of conference, more of a spectacle and stuff like that. So it's going to be nice to be playing a lot of meaningful, important games against them.
And I'm just wondering, Brady, you know, what your summer was like. Did you get up to a lot of golf this summer, or what did you do in St. Louis in your summer?
Yeah, well, coming into this summer, I treated it, my golf game, as a contract year, as either my make or break year. And that was the mindset. And that was kind of like the joke of the summer every time I went to go play. You know, golf game is just okay. There's nothing special about it. So I wouldn't say had a great golf year, but it was good. It was fun. Got to play a bunch, and but no, it's just most of summer is traveling. I had a lot of fun this summer, and got to see a lot of my friends and family, and but yeah, it was good. It was fun. Definitely created that excitement to get back, and just to get back with, you know, all the staff, teammates, and just be back in the city of Ottawa. You know, love being here. It's always fun, and always have that you know, adrenaline rush right when we get back, and the season's right around the corner. So makes me very excited.
Does that mean it was more of a break it kind of golf season than a make it golf season if you're fighting it?
I would say recently started fighting, but I, you know, had accomplished what I've wanted to accomplish. But you know what, I'd say it was good motivation for, you know, next summer. Hopefully it's a shorter summer, so I don't get that great, but yeah, no, it was good. No,
I feel better about it. Definitely using the summer now to perfect the golf game. Cause you just know the summers are about to get a lot shorter for you. So
yeah, that's the goal. Get the basis down now this summer.
Good stuff. And then obviously with the summer, there's a whole bunch of stuff. Like, I feel like it was pretty hard to kind of turn your head in any direction and not see a lot of hype surrounding either you and your brother, whether it be your brother's trade and the awesome extension that he signed, his run in the playoffs. And then obviously you had a pretty eventful summer in terms of different areas of commitment and kind of locking it down and maybe putting the first ring on your finger of many that may end up on that hand one day. So that may kind of be the goal. So I'm kind of curious if being a captain allowed you to stay poised when you popped the question, or did the nerves still kind of get to you and you blacked out a little bit, maybe don't fully remember how it went down, but at least you said yes.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I got to say some good things. She's just sitting across the room from me, but yeah, no, it was a pretty special week. Yeah, I definitely wasn't as poised as I thought I was going to be. I definitely got, right when I saw her, I definitely got a little nervous, but I don't remember what I said, but, you know, of course she remembers, and every time we tell the story of how we did it, there's always a little more fabrication than I believe it was, but I don't remember. So we always laugh about that. And yeah, it was just a special day, yeah, it was a lot of fun. And then the next day, Matthew, you know, signed his extension. So we were all together, and it was a really cool experience how, you know, almost quickly that happened. But definitely a weekend to remember, and for of course many different reasons.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that that you both kind of got out of that weekend with some pretty exciting news. So it seems like a pretty even split.
Yeah. I'd say since she's over there, I won that weekend, but yeah, no, it was good. It was a pretty awesome weekend.
Good stuff. So kind of moving into the summer of fun, and I guess kind of moving more so into the summer of focus and really kind of looking at how coming into this season and everything that's going to kind of look like, One of, I think, kind of like the first pieces that Sens fans look at is kind of that exit interview that you had with Pierre Dorion. So obviously, Pierre was like pretty vocal in kind of voicing where the team was at and kind of the different, maybe different concerns that kind of came up through that. But also just like a readiness to win and a readiness to kind of play with these guys and really kind of like knock to that next step. So I'm kind of curious, like if there was any expectations maybe that were kind of set through that conversation, were there any like goals or commitments that you left with? I know that he kind of mentioned potentially like networking with free agents or anything like that. And I was just kind of curious if you could kind of let fans in on kind of what the direction was finishing last season and focusing kind of on the off season to get ready for where the season's going to be this year.
Yeah, no, I think, you know, to start, I know you can speak of, you know, all the teammates and just went in there and you know, had my meeting with Pierre and DJ and we all came to the agreement and we all had the same thought process that we're all just sick and tired of losing and you know, every year you want to go into the year with the expectation that to win the Stanley Cup and for us the last couple of years we've kind of got off to bad starts and kind of lost that expectation in November when, you know, we were bottom of the standings and stuff like that. I think it was just kind of wearing on everybody that we want to start winning. We want to start making everybody in Ottawa proud and kind of get that support behind us. But I think for us, it was just, we all want to win. We all, like I just said, we have the expectation every summer to come in and win. And that's what drives us in the summer and motivates us is to win the Stanley Cup. And I can tell you that this is the most excited I've been going into a season and just so excited about, you know, everybody that's come in, the guys that we have, the group that kind of we've built. I'm really excited. This is going to be, you know, a very exciting year and I can tell you that, you know, everybody will do whatever it takes to win and that's just the group we have, but it's definitely going to be a really exciting year.
Were you as shocked as the rest of us when the DeBrincat news broke? Like when did you find out that that was a real possibility?
Yeah, well, I was actually just about to go to bed because it was actually the next day or something. I was in Greece for a family vacation, so I missed kind of that window of all the, you know, the trades, the drafts. So I didn't see it until the next morning. So when I saw it, I almost couldn't believe it. I was looking, I tapped to see if it was like a burner account or something that happened.
That's what we did.
I saw it and, I was definitely fired up. It's, of course, everybody, you know, sees the stats and just how see, you know, good of a player he is and how he could, he's just like that. Our team got so much better with his addition and then just getting to know him these last couple of weeks is he's a really good guy and a really good teammate as well. And you just feel, you know, his excitement, everybody else's excitement just to kind of get started and get playing in front of everybody. And I just wish we could put the fast forward button on training camp, get ready to the regular season, because I think everybody's so fired up for that.
Is he as like cool and poised around the teammates as he comes across like in his interviews and everything? Is he just kind of that cool cat, I guess, kind of lives up to his name in that sense?
Yeah, no, absolutely. He's pretty chill. Doesn't seem like much bothers him and just loves coming to the rink, loves getting better. I don't think I've seen him get, frustrated or pissed off yet. He just, like you said, he's just cool, chill and, just a really good guy.
Everyone kind of knows him for his shot, but I watched back video, like hours of video on Instat from his past season and man, like he can really make plays as well. Can you talk, like, have you seen in, I know it's been a very limited sample on your end, but have you seen that playmaking ability yet?
Oh yeah, absolutely. We've been doing some scrimmages, you know, during our, you know, informal skates there and doing some skill stuff with him, his hands, his shot, of course, his playmaking, but also his skating. He's a quick, shifty skater as well that I think, people sleep on, and he's just got a tremendous skill set. And yeah, it's not just all about a shot. He's got a lot of things in his package. And then, and as you can see on YouTube with some of his fights, he's feisty too. Yeah. So I've seen some of those and I, oh boy, throw some little bombs there with the right hand. So yeah, it definitely looks like he gets fiery too. So no, I'm excited. He's a tremendous player and he helps out the group so much already.
Well, it seems like he's just kind of another one of those guys who fits the mold of someone that you want to go to war with, and it would run through a wall with you, like you said, like with that feistiness. And kind of another guy who's been renowned as being feisty and having that compete for, I mean, over a decade at this point, is Claude Giroux. And I'm just kind of curious if you had, like, if you've had any kind of like dialogue with Giroux. Like, I know that you saw him at the All-Star game. Was there anything where you kind of thought that him coming in could be a chance, or was that another one where we were checking to see if it was a burner? Obviously, I think there was maybe a little more indication there because Dabrinkat was just kind of out of nowhere, but was that another one that you kind of found out maybe a little, was there like an inclination kind of before that there was interest or not?
Well, yeah, I kept seeing, you know, all those tweets and, you know, the inside reporters, you know, the Elliot Freeman's, Frank Cervelli's, that, you know, with weeks leading up to it, that there's interest from, you know, both sides. And yeah, I mean, I always knew it was a possibility just seeing that, but when that did happen, I was you know, pretty fired up to hear about it. I believe I heard about it. I don't know if it was that morning or whatever, but yeah, it was definitely exciting just to get a guy like that, get also a player like that. It's going to help out our group a lot. And he's going to help me out a lot with, you know, being a captain for, you know, all those years, just to be able to learn from no experiences that he had and what he's learned and different areas to help me. And I'm very fortunate that, you know, for myself to have a guy like him and have, you know, older guys in the locker room and of course, Thomas, who, you know, I lean on a lot for, you know, different types of things. It's definitely awesome to add G to the mix there and being able to learn from, you know, him, but all those guys to make me a better leader as well.
I don't know if you heard his presser, but he talked a lot about team identity and building that identity and sort of that philosophy. But you guys have established sort of a team philosophy of being that sort of hard to play against team that gets in people's faces. Is that going to change now that you have, you know, yourself and Josh and Timmy and G and I mean, the list goes on and on. Do you guys play more of a skilled possession style now, do you think? Or are you guys still at the core, like that hard to play against team?
I think just our number one core value that I don't think we'll ever lose is our work ethic. And just we want to be the hardest working team, not only that game, but in the whole NHL. We don't want we never want anybody to come into either our building or on the road. It's and be outworked. I don't think that ever is going to happen. And then that's what you kind of see in our practices, scrimmages, that guys are working already and guys want to win. And when guys don't win, they're even pissed off already. So I think that's not going to change. That's going to be our identity and our unity too. Is just being there for one another and having each other's backs going to be another important value. But yeah, I don't think, you know, our game's going to change. It's going to be, you know, the same. And we're always going to be there, you know, working no matter what. And, yeah, I know it's, like I said, our group's already there. We're not waiting for training camp. We're already starting to create that now.
So I got to say, the Brinks truck this summer, it was really busy because it was dropping off paychecks. Obviously Matthew backed that thing up. But then in addition to Matthew signing that deal, two of your best friends got absolutely paid in Josh Morris and Tim Stutzel. So just kind of curious, like how does it feel knowing that you're going to be able to play with these guys for at least the next six seasons? Like, I mean, you always dream about playing with good friends and things like that, but kind of knowing that that's a reality for a really big chunk of the next while.
Yeah, no, it's definitely, it's unreal. It's, that's what's so great about our group is how close we are. And, like you said, as much as we have, you know, on the ice in games, practices, we have as much fun, you know, away from the rink as well, just hanging out with one another, you know, on the road and different stuff like that. And yeah, it's amazing. Both those guys, unbelievable players and absolutely deserve everything they've got. You know, they've worked so hard to get to the position they're at, and it's amazing. It's not just amazing for them. It's amazing for, you know, their families as well. Cause you know, they had a crucial part to get them to where they are. So it's an amazing moment and they absolutely deserve everything that they've gotten.
Well, and I mean, talking about, I mean, you even brought up the parents, but as if Tim wasn't already kind of stealing the hearts of Sens Nation before, first thing he says after signing this deal is how excited he is that his parents are never going to have to work again. So I'm just curious, like, can you speak to the character of this guy? Like, he's 20 years old and he's already kind of like he just seems sometimes like he's just like miles behind his years. I don't know if that's always the case. Maybe on at Jack Astor's after the fantasy draft or something, that might not be how everyone sees him. But is it kind of one of those situations where you look at him and you kind of just forget how young he is? And can you kind of just speak to the character he has?
Yeah, no, absolutely. You know, once you know, saw that, it's I'm not surprised. He's an amazing guy. He's always you know, thinking about the guy next to him, so thoughtful and always there for you. Yeah, it makes you forget now how it's not even legal to drink in the U.S. So it's definitely it's definitely crazy. But yeah, he's an amazing guy. I'm very blessed to be able to play with him for the next bunch of years and call him a great friend. He's an amazing guy. I'm just so happy for him and his family.
Now with that paycheck too, is it going to be kind of one of those things where he might have to pick up some of the bills moving forward? Or are we going to be looking at Timmy and saying, you know, stakes can have to be on you tonight. We're just not in the same pay grade.
Yeah, I'm very, very excited for a couple free meals coming up.
Absolutely. Hey, Brady, can you tell us what the mood's like overall in all these big moves get made? Everyone's super hyped. Like, do you feel that as a player? Do you feel the buzz of the city of Ottawa right now? Or is that something, you know, kind of not really weighing on your mind? Like, I know from a fan perspective, you know, going to buy tickets for the first game before they were even on sale to the general public, it was pretty much sold out. Like, is that something you guys are feeling as a group?
To be honest with you, I just see, you know, me personally, my experience is that, you know, I've seen stuff on Twitter and, you know, seen, you know, the picture of the first game seats. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was pretty, pretty crazy and pretty, it got me pretty excited. But you know, not being in Ottawa for the summer you know, definitely don't, I don't see it, like, you know, myself but I've heard, you know, I've seen through Twitter, but I've also, for the people that live here, you know, some of the staff that, of course live here and the summer as well, they are like, you guys don't know how much buzz there is right now. Like, that's what people are talking about. People are excited. Used to, be like, oh, whatever, get chirped, whatever. But right, you know, those two weeks in July, that's, I don't think I've seen a buzz like that in a long time. So, no, when I heard that got me all fired up and ready to go. I just can't wait to see it. Can't wait to see, you know, the fans at, you know, whether it's Fan Fest or, you know, the preseason schedule's not great being at home in Ottawa in front of the fans, but no, it just gets you that much more excited to play in front of everybody at the CTC for that first game.
Absolutely. You know, as a player, does that stuff matter? Like, when you're playing in a full building, do you feel that energy, or is it a little bit, you know, you're sort of zoned in and just playing hockey?
Well, I think it's, you know, I can answer that both ways, is that once the game starts, you know, you forget about everything, you just play, you just get in the zone, that aspect. But I think it's going to be, you know, pretty exciting. I'll definitely be, you know, looking around for, you know, whether it's warm-ups, first game. But honestly, I don't really think in my time here, I don't think we've played in front of a full sold-out building since I've been here. So If that ends up being the case, then it's definitely going to be really exciting. You know, come step out there and see everybody and get the game going. It's definitely going to be a pretty unbelievable feeling seeing that.
Has someone told Zub that people aren't booing him? They're actually chanting his name, because he's going to hear that now.
Yeah, yeah. No, he knows, because we do that in the locker room and in practices and stuff. So he knows that we're not booing him. He loves it. And no, it was great last year when he scored at home and the PA announcer there let everybody say Zub. So I thought that was pretty cool on the bench too.
Nice.
It's unreal. It's good to know. He's a big fan of it. So curious as well, kind of, I think you've already touched on a lot of this, but just wondering, what does having like this kind of stellar off season from Pierre Dorion, like from your general manager, like how does that trickle down into motivation for the guys? So obviously I know that like they've always been such a hardworking team to begin with. That's always been the identity, but where is that kind of like, is there kind of like a shift now where it's like, you look at the guys in the room and you look at what's there and it's like, you know, like we have something special and like, well, let's get to work. Like, let's really make this thing happen.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, in years past, you know, being able to play with some, you know, really good players and unbelievable guys and getting to, you know, learn some of those lessons throughout the years, it really, you know, helped me as a player and as a person, be able to learn from, you know, those guys, those last couple of years really helped me out a lot. But with saying that, I don't think I've ever been more excited coming into a year than I have this year and you know, having that expectation from, not only ourselves within the room, but, you know, our fan base and our community as well. It's, that definitely motivated me right from, you know, day one of the summer to come back ready to go, be in the best shape, that I've been in. So, no, I'm really excited. And like I said, I wish I could just fast forward through camp and just get the season going right away. It's, been a long time, playing. So I just can't wait to get back going again.
I know kind of going into a new year, at least like it, in the corporate world, we're always kind of setting accomplishments or objectives. And we're like, you know, this is what we want to do this year. Like, and it looks like different things that might look like kind of integral to short and long-term success for the group. I'm curious if you feel like there's any of those kind of like objectives or like accomplishments that you think will lead to short and long-term success. Like, do you think it's really integral to kind of get off to a hot start, to be able to get your power plays going, like have different power play options? Like, what do you really think is going to be what pushes Ottawa over the top?
Yeah, that's, you know, that's a good question. I think, you know, for us, I just think we need to be, you know, I think that the, you know, the start's ultra important for us. You know, we haven't gotten off to great starts in years past. And yeah, I just think if we all, you know, play for one another and, you know, keep improving our games, keep pushing each other, practice games, you know, in the gym just to push us to be better. I think if we have that mindset, I think we're really going to be a successful team. And, but yeah, that's just already the feel we have in the locker rooms that, we're already there for one another and we're a tight knit group already. And one of the, you know, the tightest groups I've been on, it's at least last week, we've for the most part, you know, we've got hanging out with most of the group. And so, no, we're all excited. We're all ready to go. And I think, yeah, I don't think we have, you know, expectations outside, you know, the room. We want to, you know, probably keep that in house and just keep that belief amongst one another, but we don't want to put that extra added pressure on us. We just want to go out there, play, and be there for one another.
Yeah. Do you guys even size up the competition? Like, are you looking at the Atlantic and looking at the East at all and looking at the teams that you could possibly sort of compete with? Or is that something that's sort of, you guys just put your head down and focus on what you need to do?
Yeah, I think that one's more of a focus on, you know, our group and focus on what we need to do to be successful and what we need to do day in and day out to put us in the best spot to be successful. So, yeah, I think our sole focus is just on ourselves and doing what it takes to get better, you know, individually and collectively as a group.
So we'll kind of leave it off with a couple maybe easier questions for you here. I feel like we've been hand you a couple exams that they're jotting down our answers to. So
no movie quotes though.
Yeah.
Tough one.
Stay clear of those. So I was fortunate enough to actually see the Killers in concert a couple weeks ago, and I got to say, I'm not sure that the vocals top that of yours or Josh's when Mr. Brightside came on. And I'm just kind of wondering, since there can only really be one Mr. Brightside, can you confirm if it's you or Josh?
Oh, I mean, I think he knows better than anyone that he knows that's my song, and he knows that's me. So I think I'd have to get myself on that one. He's been around multiple times where that song's come out, and he's seen me do my work there. So, I got to give it to myself.
Hey, did you ever hear, Danny Heatley kind of humming along and singing that song like way back when? I know I got a Heater jersey behind me, but just curious if you heard that. I think it was a pre-gamer or something, and he was mic'd up.
Yeah, I heard that. Yeah. I heard that, I don't know. It must have been over the summer or when it happened. I saw that somebody tweeted out, a montage of the Heart and Crown. So I definitely saw that. I got a good chuckle out of that one too.
Right on. Any chance you guys look to alter your goal song? Like, that's a big topic for whatever stupid reason on Sen's Twitter. It's a big topic this summer. Like, should you go to Mr. Brightside? Like, that's your jam. Do you guys go to a different goal song, or do you keep song two, the current song that you guys have? Or is there any possible way, like the MLB does, where, a guy's coming up to bat and he has his own particular song? Do you think there's any chance the NHL eventually adapts, like whoever scores gets their song played?
I know some teams have done the individual goal song. You know what? I like our song. I think it's a good song. Yeah. It's fitting for our group, and I feel like it's everybody can be a part of it too. You don't have to know like memorize words or anything like that. It's just you pretty much do the woohoo sound. So it's I like it. I think it's good for us.
Do you what do you like more, the song or the horn?
That's
the horn's iconic.
Yeah, it's tough to beat the horn. I mean, I like the combo. I think it's a good combo, perfect mix.
Political. He's getting more and more political. I like it.
I know.
Giroux must already be working his magic on you. So I'm curious as well on that sense. So you're a young guy, same time you're a leader. Obviously that letter on your chest shows that. And we're curious if you have any advice for kind of like the more inexperienced players coming up. So we know that you're always reaching out to whether it be guys who get drafted or kind of are young and within the system, and maybe some advice that like you had shared with you over the years, or just kind of something that you kind of like to tell guys, whether it be to just kind of stick with it or to soak everything in or have fun with it, whatever it might be.
Yeah, well, I think, ever since I was a kid, and I've taken these two things that my dad used to always tell me is be the hardest worker and be a good teammate. And I've taken that, from youth hockey all the way up to now. And that's just, what I tell guys. And if things aren't going well, it'll eventually all work out. So there's never like a don't need to get stressed about it all. No, come back if you're being the hardest worker and being a good teammate. So and I think that if you can accomplish that, then you kind of give that off to teammates and they can learn to, whether do that or master that. Then if you get a group to do that, then that's when, teams get successful. So, because, you're pushing each other to be the best. So, those are definitely, the things I give advice to if needed, or a guy asks for it. But I just think that's ultra important, not just for now, but for kids growing up playing youth hockey. I think that's the most important thing that you can do.
And on that same note, when you were drafted, there was this kind of uproar, and it was a different time in sort of Sens fandom history. There was, you know, all this talk of, you know, it should have been Philip Zadina, and no one's saying that now. But Tyler Boucher, I think, went through a really similar thing. Have you ever had that conversation with Boucher? Cause I know he's a great kid. And I actually feel bad for calling him a kid, cause he can kick the shit out of me. That guy is absolutely built up. But, did you ever have that conversation with him?
Yeah, no, I you know, quite frankly, I think it's unfair, and I don't think it's no right, for people to, say that or certain things, because, like you said, he's an amazing guy. We're absolutely going to need him, and we know that, that's the type of player he is, and, for successful teams, those are the type of guys that you have to win, and he's not only skilled, great shot, great skater, but he's just such a hard worker and such a tough guy to play against. And I know for sure, seeing him skate, I've been very impressed. I think he's a unreal player and even a better guy too. And that's, the type of player, type of guy that we're going to need to take us to the next level. And we're glad we have him. I'm very excited to see him progress this year and see him play in person, live, during training camp and stuff like that. And if I could say something to, Sens fans is that we're going to, absolutely, we're lucky to have him, and definitely he's going to take us to that next step. So no, definitely really excited to have him.
Well said. All right, Brennan, now you want to introduce the next segment?
Yeah. So, Bear with us, Brady, because I don't think it would be a Future Sickos episode if we didn't make you cringe and maybe question why you decided to come on. But I think that was just off the bat. So yeah. One of the side notes we have here is we wanted to play a couple karaoke songs in honor of your and Josh's performance, and we want you to pick who would most likely sing this song.
I like this one a lot.
It's a bit better than the movie quotes because we actually have the song in front of us too. So
perfect.
Even we're not just going to be hammering out names. So we got Tyler on the mic here. And the first one is "What Is Love" by Hathaway. So take it away, Tyler.
What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me.
That rocks, bro. I like
it. Yeah, maybe.
Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me.
Oh, that's a good one. I gotta go with that one. I gotta go with Holdy. I feel like he'd enjoy that one a lot. He'd get the head nod, like the crazy ones where he's whipping his whole body into it. So I gotta go with Holdy on that one. I could see him vibing out to that.
The helmet, glasses, and all, just absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Really get this neck involved.
O'Doyle rules, baby. So the next one on deck, we've got a classic from, maybe the queen of country. It's "Party for Two" by Shania Twain.
Yeah. I'm having a party. A party for two.
Oh.
Inviting the party.
That's a good one. I mean, the only guy I could think of with that one was Josh. I feel like he could really get into that one, and I think he's a Shania fan. So if it's not him, we have one of our good buddies, Brom, or one of our equipment guys. I could see him loving that. So I saw him at Boots and Heart going nuts to Shania. So I'm like, okay, that's the first guy I thought of. So I'd go with Brom on that one.
Unreal. Next on deck, it's probably the most sung karaoke song of all time. I'm sure you've been to Fenway before, so I don't know if this one even needs the play, but we'll still get Tyler on the mic anyways. It's "Sweet Caroline" by Neil Diamond.
Touching hands, reaching out.
You gotta love the build up in this one.
I know. It's such a good karaoke song.
Oh, yeah.
It gets people going.
You have to be sauced up, though. you gotta be sauced.
Yeah, I'd
sing it right now.
I'd go with Shabby on that one. That I could see that at like a function. I could just see him singing it. So, yeah, I think he'd be good. Get into it, you know, get everybody involved. The touching hands, touching, reaching out, and all that part. So, yeah, I'd go with him.
Get the dance moves going and everything. And then the last one we got, we just want to hit. Got to hit every genre. So we've got the one hit wonder Vanilla Ice with his Ice Ice Baby.
I gotta go with Waddy on this one. I just see Waddy belt that one out.
Great big chain hanging from his neck or something.
Yeah, like that could be a good
no shirt.
That could be a good karaoke. Obviously. Yeah.
So what I work with saw Vanilla Ice in concert a couple of weeks ago, and I was like, oh, does he still have it? And he's like, he has it as much as he's ever had it. Which, yeah. I don't
know. Is that a compliment or is it? Yeah. No doubt. So Brady, before we send you off, I took some Twitter questions just from some fans. They had some questions for you. So we'll send you off with these last few questions. So Daryl Quinlan asks, what did you and Elfie discuss during your day date?
Yeah, no, it was just, you know, a different range of things. And, you know, talked about his, you know, coaching, you know, youth hockey and his kids. And, yeah, we talked about, you know, the golf game and different stuff like that. And just talked, you know, different experiences that, you know, he had being a captain in the city. And, know, different things where he could help out with me. And yeah, it was definitely an awesome lunch getting to know him, and I'm looking forward to get to know him even more throughout these years.
Absolutely. And the second question I have for you is from Le Chat, and I'm probably not saying that right. I think it's a French name for cat.
Literally means cat.
Okay.
Translates.
I have no idea. I can't speak French, but when you pick up the cup for the first time, who do you hand it to first and why?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I don't know if I want to go to it. I'm not going to answer that one. We'll see when we get there and keep everybody surprised. Don't want to get too ahead of ourselves. And yeah, I guess we're going to have to see when that time comes.
Fair enough. Kyle Skinner from Dine Sports asks, what's your backup karaoke song to Mr. Brightside? So everyone wants to know about the karaoke.
Yeah. I like Elton John. So, you know, one of like his hits, Tiny Dancer, Rocket Man.
Oh,
our song. Awesome. There's a lot of great options there that can sing and really get the crowd going and get a little sing along as well.
They definitely, no doubt. Did you get to see him in concert when he was?
I saw him actually a couple of years ago in Vancouver. We were there for preseason. Up there, so got to see him, and that was a bucket list concert. Mm-hmm. I had a blast. I loved it, and it was an amazing experience.
Nice. I know he was just in Ontario last week, and it looks like he definitely still has it. That's for sure.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Still the Rocket Man. Always the Rocket Man.
Absolutely.
All right. And Papa Pierre, another one about the cup, wants to know, when you guys win the cup in the next couple of years, what are you drinking or eating out of it? Is that another one that you're going to save, or?
I'm going to save that. Everybody can get the surprise when it happens.
That's right. That's right.
Give it a cliffhanger.
And the final question I have from Twitter is from Marco Levac, who wants to know, Brady, would you be my friend?
Perfect. Absolutely. Sounds good with me.
Awesome. Well, listen, Brady, thank you so much for joining us. I got to say, cheers.
Cheers.
Thank you so much, man. Another cringe ending from Future Sickos. And, we hope we can catch up with you mid-season at some point.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, guys. Hey, enjoy.
Thank you so much, man. Take it easy.
See ya.